Good evening. Everybody have a good day? Say, yes, I did. The day the Lord has made, amen. We get to rejoice and be glad in it. But I'm so glad one of my high school friends is here that I haven't seen in a long time. It's so good to see you, Jackie. And I'm excited I get to speak tonight and you get to hear me. Yay. But y'all have to hear me too. You know, whenever I am asked to speak, and you might say, you know, how do you determine what you're going to speak on? Obviously, you're led by the Spirit of God, but the way that the Holy Spirit speaks to me is something, it just grabs me. I could be listening to a message, and they could be reading a scripture, and it just jumps out at me, so to say, and the Holy Spirit just grabs me. And I know this is what the Holy Spirit wants for me to speak on. And so tonight I'm going to be talking about praise. What I believe that the Holy Spirit led my heart to is on a life of praise. How many of you know, as people of God, we should live a life of praise? Not on just Sundays and not on just Wednesdays. It's a life of praise that we should be living unto God. So the title is A Life of Praise. And in the Christian life, we know that praise is something that we give to God for all the wonderful things and all the blessings that He has done for us. But not only that, we praise Him, not just for the things that He's done for us, but the things that He's doing now, and the things that we know that He's going to do for us as well. But how many of you would agree and have experiences from your life that it's easy to praise God on the mountaintop? When you're on the mountaintop, it's easy to praise God. It's easy to praise God when you're on the other side of the battle. When you've come out of the battle in victory, it's easy to look back and to praise God, isn't it? But how many of you know that it can become more of a challenge in your life when you feel like you're in the valley? Or even during those times when you're facing those difficult situations and those battles in your life. Praising the Lord is usually more of a challenge during those times. But did you know that praise is a choice that we make? God's not going to make us praise. It's a choice that you and I make in our everyday life. You see, as Christians, we don't just praise God when we feel like it. Pastor Mark on Sunday that we need to be growing up, right? And so part of growing up is getting past doing something just because you feel like it. It's a Christian discipline that you do it whether you feel like it or not. It's a choice that we make. It's a choice that we choose to make to praise God day by day, hour by hour, our praise unto the Lord. So if you'll turn to Psalms 34 with me. So if you're facing a battle, one of the greatest tools that God has given us is the tool of praise. In Psalms 34, I'm going to start with verse 1, and this is what it reads. I will. Everybody say, I will. I will. I will bless the Lord at all times, and His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Verse number 2, my soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Verse number 3, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Some things that I just want to just briefly look at here is we go back to praise is what? It's a choice. And here we have in the psalmist said, I'm making a deliberate choice, not by how I feel, but I will bless the Lord. How, when, and how often? And in what circumstances? At all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So it's a choice that we make, whether in the good times of life, on the mountaintop, or in the valleys of life, that we make a decision that, you know what? No matter what comes my way, I make a decision. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall be in my mouth. So one, we make a decision to bless the Lord, and not just at the moment, but also ahead of times in situations, we make a decision that we're gonna bless the Lord. How many people get in a decision and or in a circumstance and that day they decide, I don't think I'm gonna praise God today? Or how many people get up on a Sunday morning and go, I don't feel like going to church today. I'm not gonna go. So in the moment they make a decision. But in the things of God, we purpose in our heart ahead of time. No matter what happens, I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. Now, David is writing this psalm. And when I study the life of David and when I study a lot of characters in the Bible, Mark and I talk about this quite frequently. We can't make this stuff up. I mean, it's crazy the things that God has put in the Word of God from their life. And we stop and we read and go, seriously, you can't make this stuff up. That if you would tell somebody, they would literally laugh if they knew nothing about the Bible. Like, that's not really in there. No, that's really in there about people's lives. And David, continually running from Saul, continually being chased by enemies, he said, you know what? Regardless of what I'm facing, I will bless the Lord. So we make a decision and we purpose in our hearts today, no matter what tomorrow brings, I will bless the Lord. So no matter what we are facing here on earth, we need to make a determination. I will bless the Lord. Because church, too many Christians live the Christian life by feelings and not by a decision. If I feel like it, I will do it. Well, then you won't be doing it very often. You make a decision to do it. I was listening to Joyce Meyer, and this is just kind of a side story that will help to bring this point home. And for those of you that don't know who Joyce Meyer is, she's married to a guy by the name of Dave Myers. And just Joyce, of course, has an awesome testimony. But if you have listened to Joyce in their earlier years, you know, about him wanting to golf all the time, it caused a lot of marriage problems. And now they're to the point they've been married, I believe, for over 50 years. It's like, yes, please go golfing. Get out of the house. Please go. But she was talking to Dave one day, and Dave is an avid sports nuts. He loves to watch it on TV. He loves to play it. And so she asked Dave, she said, you know, have you ever thought about what you would do if you were not ever able to play sports? And he said, yeah, in fact, I have thought about that. And he says, and I have already made a decision that if it ever comes to that in my life, that I will be just as joyful as I am because I've already made a decision ahead of time. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. He hasn't got to that point yet. So how do you know that he's going to do that? I believe once we make a decision and we determine in our heart that that is what we are going to do, that when that time comes, we will walk in that. But we have to make a decision ahead of time. I will bless the Lord at all times. So at all times and in every situation. Now we know in Thessalonians it says that we are to give thanks in everything in Christ Jesus because this is the will of God concerning you, right? So it's not that we're giving God thanks for all the problems that we're facing, right? But in our situations and in our difficulties, we give thanks and we give praise. That is part of the will of God for our life. So many people are looking to the will of God in these things, and it's right. Here's one right from the Word of God. Let's start right here. This is a good will of God right here to start with. Giving thanks to God in everything. For this is the will of God. And it goes on to say that continually we should be praising God. It's not just a one-time deal. What does Psalms 113 verse 3 say? From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, his name is to be praised. Verse number 2 in Psalms 34 says, my soul, where the mind, the will, and the emotions come from, right? The decision making. My soul, whoa. Sorry, guys. My soul. Maybe if I say it a different way. My soul shall make her boast in what? In the Lord. So we're magnifying the Lord and we're boasting about the Lord, right? We're not boasting about all of our problems. Hello? We're not boasting about all of our problems. We're boasting about the Lord and we're magnifying. When you're boasting about something, and hopefully it's not about yourself, hopefully you're boasting in the Lord, but when you're boasting about something, you're bragging about something, right? Our boast, our brag should be in the things of God, in the Lord. We should be praising God and boasting about how wonderful that he is. And then verse number 3 says, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Again, what should we be magnifying? The Lord. How many of you know of people that go through situations and the only thing they're magnifying is their problems? You haven't heard one thing of scripture, one thing about God in their problems. All they are is magnifying how big their problems are. But I'm here to tell you, no matter how big your problems are, I serve a God that is bigger than any problems that you might face. We know that God doesn't get bigger. You know, I was thinking about this the other day. I remember in children's church when I was a kid,
and they would talk about God as a big God. And I was thinking the other day, as the imagination of a child, when you would tell me that God is a big God, I envisioned this huge God that was sitting up in heaven. His muscles were so huge that nobody would want to mess with him. The imagination. That's why I thought, you know, we have to be really careful about how we teach children because of what they're envisioning, right? Our God is a big God. And he's bigger than any situation that you're facing. So quit looking at your problems as bigger than your God and begin to magnify God, even though God's not going to get any bigger because he's as big as he can be already. But it'll change you as you begin to magnify the Lord. So let's not magnify all of our problems. Let's magnify the Lord. So I would just want to encourage you, if you, by faith, if you will get your mind focused and stayed, there's a key word, stayed on the promises of God and let those promises build you up. I can promise you, if you will take in these promises and you will believe and trust them, they will build you up. They will build you up. I can promise you, when you go to the Word of God and you begin to look to what the Word of God says and you will stay focused on the Word of God, your problems that you have made in such a big mountain will look like an itty-bitty anthill when you compare it to how big your God is. So we need to be focusing on God and magnifying God. And you know, when we begin to do that, did you know that praise, you won't have to struggle to try and praise. It'll be easy. As you begin to focus on God and his word, praise will just easily come forth from your life. You won't have to I got to strain and struggle. No, it'll come forth easy. You know, you may have had a very rough day today. I don't know what your day has been like. And today, you may be facing some of life's most difficult challenges. And you know, you came to church tonight, and you may not admit it to anybody, but you came in not really wanting to praise the Lord. But as the praise and worship team and the congregation began to sing praises to God, and you began to take your focus off the problems, and you began to remind yourself of who God is and what he has done for you and what he is able to do, it did something in you. Your problems did not disappear, but it changed you. It changed your attitude and it changed your focus. You see, praise is designed to be a blessing towards God, right? It's designed to be a blessing towards God, but aren't you glad that there's added benefits to praise, that praise does something for you as well? In Isaiah 61:3, it says, put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. There is something about praise that God designed, even though it is designed to be a blessing towards God, it does something in us. Put on that garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So some of you came in with the spirit of heaviness, but as you began to put on praise and you began to praise God, that heaviness left. Because you began to put God in the right perspective. So now let's turn to Hebrews chapter 13. And let's look at verse 15. In Hebrews chapter 13, in verse number 15, it says this: By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. Kind of sounds similar to what we just read in Psalms 34, doesn't it? But it goes on, and we know that Paul, there's debate on who is the author of the book of Hebrews, but I attribute it to Paul as being the author of the book of Hebrews. But Paul tells us, as believers, that we are to offer God something. And what is that that we are to offer God? It's called a sacrifice of praise. How often? Continually. The fruit of our lips giving thanks unto his name. Why do you think that he called it a sacrifice of praise? You don't have to answer out loud. You can just be thinking of that in your head. Well, I think we could get a lot of different answers and many different answers from that question. Why did he call it a sacrifice of praise? But I believe that one reason that he called it a sacrifice of praise is because it is a decision that you make apart from how you feel. You do it, this is praise, you do it even when you don't really want to. Even when it's difficult. Even when you are facing difficult circumstances and when things and people are coming against you. It's in those times that you make a decision that you are going to praise the Lord and lift up sacrifices of praise to him. You see, a sacrifice of praise is different from the praise that we give God for what he has already done. It's easy to praise God when we are out of the situation, right? And we look back and all the things that he's done, it's easy for us to lift up our voice and to praise him. But a sacrifice of praise is different. You know why it's different? Because we're facing challenging situations and we don't know what tomorrow holds. And we trust God that we don't know how he's going to bring us out. We just know that he's going to. And it's a sacrifice of praise. God, I don't know how you're going to bring me out. I don't know how you're going to do this. I don't know what tomorrow brings, but I offer you this sacrifice of praise because I know that you're faithful and you're going to bring me out. And you're going to bring me out in victory. A sacrifice of praise is a choice that we make to praise him in the difficult times of life. Not knowing how God is going to bring us out or when he will bring us out. That's always God. Like, it's been 10 minutes. But we praise God because we know that he will bring us out in victory. That's why we offer a sacrifice of praise to God continually, the fruit of our lips giving thanks unto his name. If you'll turn with me now to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. This is a story that we're all familiar with. But a life of praise, and a life of praise is a decision that we make. Not by how we feel, but it's a decision that we make that we are going to praise the Lord. Again, this is a story that I'm sure that we're familiar with. This is the story of King Jehoshaphat. And he's surrounded by armies. And let's just read a little bit of this story in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Are you there? Say there. Okay. It came to pass after this also that the children of Moab, the children of Amnon, and with them other besides the Ammonites, came against Jehoshaphat to battle. Verse number 2. Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, "There cometh a great multitude against you from beyond the sea on the side of Syria, and behold, they that be in Hazazon Tamar," which is in Gedi. Verse number 3, "And Joseph feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judea." Just some things that I would like for us to gather from this story or learn from this story is Jehoshaphat was surrounded by more than just one army. There was a host of armies that were surrounding Jehoshaphat. And he knew that in the natural, there was no way that the Israelite army could defeat them. So I want to ask you this question. Can you relate to Jehoshaphat? Have you ever felt like you were surrounded by problems or surrounded by enemies? Have you ever felt like Jehoshaphat? And in verse number 3, and the minute that you hear the report of what is coming against you, fear tries to come. It says Jehoshaphat feared. Now here's the thing about fear. Fear tries to come. It's not out of faith that fear tries to come, because I can tell you the tactic of the enemy. He is going to try and bring fear into your life. When you're facing circumstances that you don't know what to do, or a report that it just left you devastating, fear will try and come. But here's the thing. What are you going to do with the fear? You have a choice. Are you going to let the fear enter, or are you going to resist the fear? I believe the story does not say exactly, but even though Jehoshaphat was being tempted to fear, I believe he resisted the fear. And you know why I believe he resisted the fear? Because the very next verse goes on to say, "And Jehoshaphat sought the Lord." I want to ask you a question. If you're facing something difficult, have you sought the Lord? Have you asked the Lord, "Lord, give me direction"? Have you asked the Lord, "Lord, what am I supposed to do?" Because sometimes we just want to go gung-ho and just do whatever we want to do without even asking God. And then we want God to bless it. How about let's ask God, "God, I am facing this difficult situation. What do I do?" Verses 6 through 12 of this chapter is Jehoshaphat's prayer, and Jehoshaphat praying unto God, which is some great things that are in that prayer, but we don't have time to look at those. So we're going to skip down to verse number 13. And it goes on to say, "And Judea stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and all their children. Then Hazel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, and I'm going to skip all that. But the Spirit of the Lord came upon him in the midst of the congregation, in verse number 15, and he said, "Hearken, all Judea and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou, King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude." Oh, these are words that we like to remind ourselves with, don't we? "For the battle is not yours, but it's God's." Verse number 16, "Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel." Verse number 17, "You shall not need to fight in this battle." It's a good thing to seek the Lord and ask him what to do. And he said, "Set yourself, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you." And Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judea and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Now, at this point, they haven't won the battle, right? They have just received word from the Lord of what they are to do. They are people of praise and worship. They're praising and worshiping God even before they're going into the battle. They don't know for sure that they're going to win. They have a word from the Lord, and they believe God's word, right? And the Levites and the children and the those kind of Thites and the Korites stood up to praise the Lord of Israel with a loud voice on high. Can I say that praise has a voice? Praise has a voice. And verse number 20, "And they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness." And I'm going to skip down to verse number 21. "And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of his holiness, as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever." Verse number 22, "And when they immediately began to sing praises, to sing and to praise the Lord set ambushment against the children, against all those that were basically coming against them, and they were smitten." Now, here's, I know, a story that we are all familiar with. And this is one of those stories that are in the Bible, and you go, we can't make this stuff up. God sent praisers out before the army. And none of the army, of God's army, back then they used arrows. Nobody used a weapon. Not one natural weapon was used in that battle. Church, this is real. This is not a fictitious story. What can we learn from this? That we need to get our praise and worship team and we need to send them out forth in front of all of our problems? Obviously not. But what we do need to do is we need to send out our praises in front of our battles and the things that we are facing. You see, praise, I heard a minister say this one time, and he said, if you knew what was on the other side, you would praise the Lord. If you knew what was on the other side of that battle, you would praise the Lord. praise is a powerful weapon that God has given us to defeat our enemies. In the midst of our battle, praise is something that God has given to us. Although praise goes to God, right? I don't know about you, but God inhabits the praises of His people. He lives in the praises of His people. When you praise, you invite God on the scene. I don't know about you, but I want God on my scene. But there's something supernatural about praise. It's not a natural weapon. It's a supernatural weapon that God has given to us as people of God, that when we begin to praise, things begin to happen in the spirit realm, and in the spirit realm, it will then manifest into the natural realm. But it begins in the spirit realm. And praise is a weapon that God has given to us in the middle of our battles. We send the praises out. And the verse goes on to say, immediately as they began, those praisers began to praise, that it caused confusion and they began to turn on one another. I'm telling you that the enemy becomes confused when you're in the midst of a battle and you begin to praise your God. He's like, wait a minute, what are you doing? You should be complaining right now. What are you doing? You should be moaning right now. And you know why I also believe that the devil wants to try and stop our praise? You remember what he was Lucifer in heaven, the worship leader. I believe that the devil knows the power of praise and worship. And if he can get you to stop praising and worshiping God, it's like he has tied the hands of God, because praise invites God on the scene. And immediately, as we go to praise God in the middle of our situations, to the world, it's crazy. But it's also a great testimony to God in the middle of our situations when we're facing horrible, terrible circumstances. As we lift our hands, I will bless your name at all times, Lord. Your praise shall continually be on my lips. It immediately, just like in that story of Jehoshaphat, immediately the enemy was confused and they turned on ambush on one another. And immediately, as you began to praise God, the enemy will be confused and he will set ambush against himself. You see, praise and worship confuses the enemy. So, church, when Satan is surrounding you with circumstances and trials, he's expecting you. He's trying to get you to give up. He's expecting you to groan and complain. He's not expecting you to rise up and praise to God. Oh, but church, when you begin to praise and to worship God in the midst of your trials and circumstances, the enemy becomes confused and it will set ambush against him. I want us to look again at verse number 21. Because they sent the praisers out, and it's interesting that the phrase that the praisers sang was, "The Lord is good, and His mercy endures forever." Now, if you read the book of Psalms, you will see that phrase a lot in the Psalms. The Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. as I read these verses and I ask myself, why would this be the phrase that God gives them to sing before the battle? Well, the Lord is good. That's giving praise to God, right? It's for who He is. The Lord is good. It's reminding them of who God is, and they're giving God praise. But then it goes on to say, and His mercy endures forever. You know, the mercy, aren't you thankful for the mercy of God? You should be if you're not. We should be thankful for the mercy of God, because the mercy of God keeps us from getting things that we deserve. Now, I believe one of the reasons that they reminded themselves that it was the mercy of God that was bringing them out of the situations. Because in the mercy of God, sometimes the battles that we're in, the devil had nothing to do with it. It's simply some choices that you have made, and you find yourself in battles. But here's the good news. The Lord is good, and His mercy endures forever. Because in God's mercy, that is what is going to bring you out, by the very mercy of God. Because you don't do everything perfectly. You need the mercy of God. They were singing this phrase, reminding them that it is by the mercy of God that He's going to deliver us. Not by us, but by simply His grace and His love and His mercy for us. So that's good news for some of you that are in these situations because of the choices that you have made. You can still cry out to God, and God in His mercy will deliver you out of situations. What time? Ooh. Are y'all staying with me? So let's now turn to Acts chapter 16. You know that we couldn't talk on praise and worship without turning to Acts chapter 16, right? And we're going to read, starting with verse number 22. Just to give you a quick background, just in case you don't know, in Acts chapter 16, we have Paul and Silas that are in Macedonia, and they are there spreading the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they come to a place of Philippi, and in this place of Philippi, there is a woman that has a spirit of divination. And Paul casts the spirit out. Well, the people get mad because from this woman they make all this money. And now that they've cast this devil out of her, they have lost their funds. And so let's look in verse number 22. And so the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And them that we're talking about is Paul and Silas. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. And verse number 24, who, having received such a charge, man, he was going to make sure that they did not escape. So he thrust them into the inner prison, not just into prison, into the inner prison, like the lowest dungeon type prison, and made their feet fast in the stocks. Now, when we think about prison systems today, it is nothing like during biblical times a prison, okay? And verse number 25, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises to God. And the prisoners did what? They heard them, because praise has a voice and it can be heard. And verse number 26, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loosed. Verse number 27, and the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. And the reason that he was going to do that is because if any prisoner escaped, they were going to kill the guard that was on duty. So he's like, they've escaped, so I'm gonna kill myself before they get to me. And then it goes, verse number 28, but Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. And then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved and thy house. So just some things that I wanted to remind us about from this story. First of all, they were in circumstances that you and I will probably never be in. Are you in stocks? Are you in a dungeon? Are you in a prison for not really even breaking any laws? Wrongfully imprisoned? And Paul was a Roman citizen. They should have never been imprisoned without even being questioned. And we would see that if we kept reading. They found real quick that they did wrong. Whoa, Paul's a Roman citizen. We're in trouble. But even at midnight in a prison cell, and remember, they had been beaten. I'm sure their bodies were in pain. And yet, they made a decision. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be on my lips. I will bless the Lord. I will offer a sacrifice of praise unto God continually. Paul and Silas didn't know if God was going to deliver them. But their praise was not based upon getting delivered. Their praise was based upon because they made a decision, I'm going to praise the Lord. So I want to just ask you, maybe it's the midnight hour for you. It's your darkest hour. You've never quite experienced some of the situations that you're in. Well, Paul and Silas can relate to that. But it doesn't matter if it's midnight and it's the darkest hour. We can still make a choice to praise God. You may be facing some of the most difficult times of your life. Your situation may be maybe like Paul and Silas. You're in this situation and really you didn't deserve it. Maybe you're in a situation that somebody else made a decision and it caused you to be in a battle. But I just want to remind you, even though we may be facing those horrible types of situations, we also need to be doing like Paul and Silas did. We need to lift our voices to God. And we need to offer the sacrifice of praise. And when we do, it immediately invites God on the scene. That's not why we praise. Our praise is not to get delivered. That is a bonus that comes from when we begin to praise God. Just like in the Jehoshaphat and sending out the armies, it confused the enemy. Just like in this situation, as they began to sing praises unto God, God delivered them. But that was a byproduct of their praise. That wasn't something that they were doing to try and get God to move. We don't praise just to try and get God to deliver us. We praise God because He is worthy of our praise. Because we have made a decision that at all times, Lord, I will bless your name. And I've said this, be real with God. God, you see my heart. You know what's going on. And I'm having a difficult time. But regardless of this difficult situation that I'm facing, I make it a choice. I'm going to praise your name, Lord. From the rising of the sun to the going down the same, your name, Lord, is to be praised. But as you begin to offer that sacrifice of praise, watch God begin to supernaturally deliver you, just like He did Paul and Silas. But as we close, I just want to point one more thing out of this story. When God supernaturally, and it was a supernatural deliverance that Paul and Silas received, did you know that it delivered others who were in that same prison? You see, your supernatural deliverance from God will affect other people too. Our life of praise and worship becomes a testimony and a witness to those around us. It says the whole jail heard them giving praises unto God. And it affected that jailer so much that, you know what? I want what you have. How do I get what you have? And he says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. But you know what? They did exactly what 1 Peter 2:9 says. You are a chosen generation. You're a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation and a peculiar people that should show forth the praises of Him who has called you out of darkness and into His marvelous light. Church, our praise is a witness to those that are around us. We should be showing forth the praises of Him who has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Let me remind you, church, Hebrews 13:15. Let us, therefore, by Him, continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks unto His name. Because praise is a powerful tool that God has given to us. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Word of God.